Hello, everyone. My name is Jordan, and welcome to the Fandom Optimist, the show where we love content and we love when it brings us together. This week in Fandom, episode 5 of Moon Knight premiered on Disney Plus. And I am joined by my good friend Blue to talk about it. Blue, I hope you liked my vague attempt at a Khonshu impression.
What? Wait, what? What? You did a Khonshu impression?
Not really. I just tried to say Moon Knight the way he said it in this latest episode of Moon Knight.
Oh, gotcha.
I love that he said it. It made me so happy.
It was cool. It was
you
like
would
a.
Be my I love, Moon Knight.
I love a good name drop. Can I say one thing before we roll right into it?
Yeah.
It's much more comfy talking to you when I'm not chained to a chair. I won't put that
yes,
out there.
Yes, I had an alter ego attack last.
You had a bit
Cape Corner.
You had a bit of a split personality situation, just like Moon Knight.
Yeah, for those who are wondering what bizarre shit we could possibly be referencing, you're going to have to go watch episode 50 of Cape Corner to find out.
The season 2 finale, baby.
Oh, Lord. Okay, so this episode broke my heart, like, over and over and over and over, and I was just emotionally exhausted by the end of it. So far in Moon Knight, I've been like, this is fun! And then by the end of this one, I watched it with my girlfriend, and I just had to pause it. Like, when we got to the credits, I just had to turn off the TV and just sit for a moment. And she was like, are you okay? I was like, I don't know. I'm really sad.
It was real upsetting. Like, it was
so much.
Like, I think last week, because I've been trying to convince one of my friends to watch Moon Knight, and I think I was turning him off with the idea when I mentioned that there was a walking hippo who had a girly voice, and he was like, oh, this sounds like dumb nerd shit. So I was like, hey, this week's episode had fucking child abuse. And
yeah, if that helps you out at all.
And survivor's guilt over the accidental death of a brother, and it was a lot.
Now, we didn't do an episode on episode 4 of Moon Knight, but you know, the big thing to talk about there was the waking up in the mental asylum. But what's crazy to me is that by the end of that episode, I was 1000% sure that was fake. I was like, yeah, okay, so all the stuff happening up to this point was definitely real. And this is now some weird hallucination he's having as he's dying. But now, but they did really good because they keep cutting between him in the doctor's office and him still in the asylum, but in this afterworld, afterlife asylum thing. And I was like, okay, so this episode made it maddeningly unclear what's real.
Yeah. And I appreciate that because, like, a lot of times when I've noticed what creators like to do when they introduce a mechanic like the character questioning their reality is that they like to do the exact same thing every time, where they also try to leave it ambiguous for the viewer, like, oh, what could be real and what could be fake? And that gets irritating after a while. Because it's like, sometimes I just want to be told a story and know with certainty what happens in the fucking story. And so this time it was like, Mark is like questioning his reality, but Steven's like, oh, this is bullshit. Got it. and so that definitely helps cement to the viewer, like, yeah, okay, this like asylum hallucination, it's just horse shit. Funnily enough, in the asylum, Dr. Harrow, quote unquote, is talking about how Mark is imagining all this like Egyptian god bullshit to try and help cope and have his mind explain the things that's happening to him. When in reality, the asylum And the doctor is actually Mark's brain playing tricks on him, trying to cope and accept the reality of what's happening to him as he's dying from the fucking interference of Egyptian gods and shit.
Yeah, it's just so well put together. Where he starts, Stephen is asking to know what happened. And he's like, you can't make me go back there. And he's like hitting himself. And I was like, oh my God, Oscar Isaac's going to kill me. And
he needs an award for this.
And look, I don't want to sound like the MCU standard of, you know, like, oh, well, Elizabeth Olsen deserves an award for that time she cried in WandaVision. And Tom Hiddleston deserves an award for that time he cried in Loki. I'm like, look, yes, they're all talented actors, and I wouldn't be opposed to any of them getting awards, but I'm like, no, I honestly will be surprised if he doesn't get some kind of an award for this.
I mean, it's one thing to act very well in portraying a character, and it's another to act very well in portraying two separate characters, and in some scenes have to switch seamlessly between them.
Yeah, and to play them up at different levels of just losing it is really good.
Exactly. So, like, speaking of Elizabeth Olsen, I saw, a tweet, of course, where someone was like, look at how samey Marvel is feeling. And they were showing direct references to the flashback episode of WandaVision, side by side with this episode of Moon Knight. And I'm just like, do you guys not know that flashback scenes like existed before WandaVision? Like, I don't think it's Marvel being samey and Moon Knight copying WandaVision. I think it's just they both happen to use this extremely common mechanic in storytelling.
Yeah, like, and I think that people have started doing that a lot. I've noticed several instances where someone's like, every Marvel movie's the same, and then they describe the hero's journey that has existed since before Greek mythology.
Well, that's what I was going to say, is that, like, it's all, like, if you ever have a mechanic in a story where we only start with part of the story, and then later we get full context, and that full context helps rally the hero to push on to the end, that mechanic usually happens around the 2/3 mark.
Yeah.
Like 2/3 of the way through the story is usually when that flashback occurs. So yeah, it was like episode seven of nine for Wanda, and it's episode 5 of 6 for Moon Knight.
Yep. Yeah.
Which, by the way, I actually, this episode did make me think, like, wait, did I get the number wrong? Is there going to be more than 6 episodes? Because that's a hell of a thing to leave episode 5 on. Like, we still got a lot to wrap up in episode 6, it feels like.
And the great part is that I have no fucking clue how.
Yeah.
I got to the end of 5, I was like, I don't know what you do. I have no idea how you get out of this. Or how do you do this?
Honestly, I'm very grateful that I never learned a whole lot about Moon Knight's stories. Like, I knew the basic idea of his character, but as far as the stories he's been a part of, I'm very ignorant, right? And that's exciting because I don't know what to expect for this series. Like, in Civil War, because I was well aware of what happened in the comic version of Civil War, I had a basic skeleton idea of what I might expect in the Civil War movie. Or because I know so much about Spider-Man, I could expect how a Spider-Man movie might conclude and so on and so forth. But Moon Knight, just knowing like his abilities and his basic backstory and like what his general deal is, doesn't let me know what kind of directions his stories tend to go in.
Yeah. It's interesting. Did you see the theory that we might have met Jake briefly in this episode?
When?
So there's a moment where, and it was very weird. I don't really know what to make of this scene because there's two different, well, there's three if you count the time at Steven. There's three different moments where he wakes up in the doctor's office with Dr. Harrow in this episode. And it was really weird because in the first one of them, he's got some blood on his face and a bloodied bandage on his nose. And he's looking really worse for wear. And the second time he wakes up here, they inject him with something. He goes back into the weird afterlife stuff with the hippo. And then he wakes up here again when he starts hitting himself in the face. Bandage is gone. He looks totally cleaned up. And he says, "Did you inject me with something?" And he's like, "No, man, we don't. That's not true. We don't. That's not. You're watching too many movies. We don't do that forcefully unless we absolutely have to." And then he goes back into the thing. Or maybe, yeah, he goes back into the thing.
You're thinking Bandage Nose was Jake and not Mark.
Yes, because it's very odd. I rewatched the scene, and there is something weird about it, because it doesn't sound like Mark, really. There's a couple lines in there where he sounds like he has kind of a New Yorker accent, maybe.
I'm not...
His general tone doesn't feel like Mark. It was a very weird scene. I don't know what to make of it.
I'm not completely against that, but I have a little bit of difficulty fully believing that either, because when it goes back to Mark the second time, he feels around his nose for the bandage.
Oh,
so
yeah.
Mark would have had to be conscious to know that he was wearing a nose bandage last time.
Yeah, it's a weird moment because I guess it's just Mark really snapping there, because he's losing it in that one with the bandage.
Yeah.
He's like, "You're not a doctor." And then he goes, and then he like just gets up and he's like, "I feel much better, really. You're great, man. You must make a lot of money in this kind of place, you know?" And he's like laughing and just kind of delirious. It was a disturbing acting moment. Very good.
If we are to believe that the only reason Steven was able to pop up in the office is because he's not in that fucking sarcophagus anymore, then don't forget, there was another sarcophagus that Mark never opened. And I'm pretty sure that Jake is in there. So
that's true.
Man, fucking, okay. Steven, I wasn't sure at first. In the first episode, I was like, I want to see more of Mark. And Mark is cool. But, like, I've become so endeared to Steven. And this episode, like, he is literally told that he's dead. And he's just like, "Oh, the duot. Oh, this is so cool." And I'm like, "Oh my god, what a fucking treasure. We don't deserve Steven."
I love him.
I really appreciated him. He started hiding and letting Mark fight. And he's like, "Come on, Mark, you've got this." And then he's like, "Wait, if I'm you, then I've got this too." And he just starts kicking the shit out of them. So good. Because, like, what's so wild is the revelation. So initially the story presents us as though Steven is the one in danger and Mark is the one that can protect him. Like at the end of episode one, when Mark is like, "Let me take over the body. I can save us," right? Like Mark is the competent one. Mark is the one that can get shit done. And truthfully, Steven was created to be Mark's protector. He was created to shield Mark from, like, the damaging thoughts and feelings that he was going through. And at the end, Steven continued to act as Mark's protector.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Which is really sad.
It's, good God. Yeah, the moment that he finds out that he's made up, just put me in tears. I was losing it, man.
Yeah. And the fact that Mark fought so hard against Steven to keep him from learning the truth, because he it seems like he genuinely cared about Steven enough to want him to believe he was like a real person. Like, I mean, everything from setting up the flat and like replacing his fish and trying to keep him out of the loop of like shit that's going on and trying to fight so that he wouldn't see the memory of his own creation and all this stuff. It's like he wanted to protect Steven from the truth, which again is a fantastic bit of written irony in that Steven himself was created to protect Mark from the truth.
Yeah.
It's just so deep and complex with the writing, and I love it.
Yeah, and the way they did the deal with the mom, that really got to me, because I had just assumed up to this point that he was leaving actual voice messages for someone, whether it was her or a number that's no longer in use because she's passed. That's what I thought.
But you can see in the flashback, the first time that Steven and Mark started to really split and diverge.
Yeah.
That when he pulls up a home screen. Yeah.
he was never talking to anyone. I mean, that just broke my heart when I saw that.
Yeah.
This episode was mean.
And I appreciate that they gave enough confidence to their viewers that they didn't like do a zoom in on the home screen or anything. They just like had it barely there in the field of vision for people to pick up on themselves.
Yeah, and like, and similarly emotional when Dr. Harrow is saying, "Yeah, let's just call Mrs. Grant. We'll call her." And he's going, "No, don't do that. Don't. She's busy. She's probably, you don't need to bother her, please." And he's like getting more and more distraught as he's closer and closer to having to confront that she's not there.
I'm aware that like the whole like hospital thing is like a hallucination, right? But like pretending for a second that this is an actual doctor doing actual doctor things, what is the plan there?
Yeah, that bothered me a little bit.
Like what was on the other end of that phone? Was it just fucking silence? Like
it
just
was. Seems like we hear it's a dial tone.
It seems needlessly cruel to do that. Like, as a doctor, you are meant to comfort your patients, and up until that point, he had been very comforting with his like tackling of the truth. But that was just like needlessly shitty.
Yeah, it was very upsetting.
Yeah.
Gosh, it's such a good show. Oh my god.
Yeah, it really is.
Man, we've been so out of order. I don't even know what to talk about next.
I was really upset that Steven falling off the boat was enough to make Mark's scales balance. And then all of a sudden he just popped up in the field of reeds. And I was like, but what about fucking Osiris's gate? Like,
yeah, that threw me for a loop a little bit. They were going somewhere, and she kept saying balance the scales before we get to the gate. And then they balance it, and he goes to the field. Like, I'm confused.
Does she have to pick him up from there? Like, what happens?
Yeah, I'm very confused about that. I'm also, like, I'm not going to say worried, because I have faith that Marvel's not going to do something stupid. But that it's like, okay, so is Steven, like, gone? Does he no longer have dissociative identity disorder? Is it going to be that, look, getting rid of dissociative identity disorder made him okay enough to get balanced scales? It's like, well, that's going to be an upsetting message in yeah. terms of mental health. I hope that's not where they're going. I hope I'm just more context will surely light our way. But
I hope that if anything, it shows that Mark is more distraught, and that losing Steven was literally losing a piece of himself, and that he's not more complete now. Speaking of upsetting things, I know a lot of people have been really agitated with the lack of Jewish representation in here. I would like to speak my mind on this a little bit. And don't worry, given the way I normally am, this might actually throw some of you guys for a loop. Okay. this would normally be the part where I would say, well, like, he had a yarmulke in the episode, and you know, they mentioned a Shiva, which I didn't know what it was, so I had to Google it, and I learned a little thing about Jewish people and all that. Mm-hmm. And I might be like, you know, it's fine, just because they weren't like super in your face about it with the Jewish representation doesn't mean that it wasn't there. But to be perfectly honest, because I haven't read the Moon Knight stories, I don't know how prevalent his Judaism is in the story. I don't know what would be more accurate and more faithful to the character if this little touches of like, by the way, he's Jewish, is enough, or if it isn't. So in this instance, I will take a step back and say, I do not have enough information to have an informed opinion. I would have an ignorant opinion if I was stating it. Yeah. And so I'm going to trust others who know the character better than I do to make that judgment.
Yeah. And if Judaism is like as important to Moon Knight as Catholicism is to Daredevil, then yes, then they're not doing it.
Probably wouldn't be enough. Yeah.
but I don't know that. I've not read the comics.
Yeah. So I just say, for me, as this adaptation is my first exposure to the character, and not knowing a fantastic amount about Judaism myself anyway, I thought that it had enough to like make me realize that it's a part of him. And it was fine for me. But for those of you who might be upset, I have literally no reason to say that you're wrong. I do not know enough.
Yeah. I do, you know, I like that the representation for it that was there was just casually thrown in there. I like when something's able to do that. That, you know, like a what was the word, Shiva? That it's like they gave no context, they just threw it in. I was like, oh yeah, cool. You like, trusted that I would figure out what that meant. That's nice.
Yeah.
I always like, and when like, something's that casually thrown into something, I don't know how to describe it. But yeah, the normalization of representation is kind of,
yeah, exactly,
put it, and I like,
yeah,
it.
And by the way, the reason I was saying like I might throw people for a loop with that. Like I probably have been developing a reputation as our like podcasting days have gone on for like being an extremely opinionated, I'm right, you're wrong, smart alecky kind of jackass. Mm. But I only do that if I truly feel I know what I'm talking about.
Yes.
And in this instance, I can fully admit I don't know what I'm talking about. And so I don't want, because like I can be an ass, but I don't want to be an ignorant ass. I want to be, yes, an ass who knows what he's talking about.
And on a greater, you know, life lesson thing, that's just a good way to be in general. It's like, don't go die on a hill if you have no idea what the fuck you're talking about.
Exactly. I feel like that's something more people could stand to learn, for sure.
Inform yourself before picking your battles.
Yeah.
It's the best way to put that.
I will fight tooth and nail about something I believe very strongly, but if I don't know what I'm talking about, I'm going to be like, eh, it's fine. I'll take, yeah, a step back.
Yep. We had a poll. I could read that. That's a thing. Way back in episode 3, we put out a poll, assuming Jake Lockley was the cause of the unseen violence in episode 3, will we meet him directly in the next episode, which we never got around to covering. 55% voted yes, 36% voted not yet, and 9% voted that wasn't Jake. So, definitely the yes crowd turned out to be wrong, but I guess we're still on the fence about those other two.
Who else would it be if not Jake? Like,
I don't know.
It didn't seem like it was Khonshu, because he didn't say anything about it.
Yeah, I don't know. I have no idea what it would be. I just thought I should put that in. And interestingly, 9% of people voted for it.
Yeah.
There's your poll result for this week. Oh, I think my favorite thing in this episode, barring all the emotional stuff, was the little shout out to the ancestral plane. It was so cool to me to learn that there are multiple afterlives based on what you believe in the Marvel universe. That's cool.
That is great. I love that view of, well, cause like for one, that is like on a purely logical level, that's the only way you can make a bunch of the shit in the MCU or in Marvel make sense, given that when you initially depict a superhero character and you have the mythology surrounding them, but then you put that superhero character into a greater world with other superheroes, their mythologies need to be able to coexist. And if Thor's Valhalla and Wakanda's ancestral plane and Moon Knight's Egyptian afterlife, like if they cannot all coexist, then a bunch of those characters have to be just made crazy, which is ironically what they did to Thor in the Ultimate Universe. Well, initially Thor was depicted as just a crazy eco-terrorist who thought that he was Thor, the God of Thunder, but he was superhuman.
I don't like that at all.
Yeah, the Ultimates fucking sucked, because Captain America was also, like, a super conservative boomer, like, borderline neo-Nazi. Yeah. He hated immigrants, and...
which, ironically, is what a lot of uninformed people think that Captain America is by default. Because it's in... Just because America is in the name. America doesn't have to be a problem. Unless we let it be.
The Ultimates was... It was the early 2000s attempt at making Marvel comics super fucking edgy. And that's why we got shit like crazy eco-terrorist Thor, Boomer, Captain America. And
is
Wanda
that the run
and...
where they had the Blob eat the Wasp?
Probably.
Because I've heard a lot about that. That's like the worst thing Marvel ever did or something.
No, I promise you it's not. Especially given that the Ultimates also had Wanda and Pietro fuck.
Oh yeah, I forgot about... Oh, Jesus Christ. Oh my god. Dude, the fucking Ultimates, oh my god.
Yeah. Look, let's not harp on the Ultimates too much. We all like to pretend that it doesn't exist, just like Mar-Vell. I don't know if you even know what Mar-Vell is.
I don't think I do.
I read the first issue of it recently. It's so fucking bad. It's like an extremely meta, like, fucking parody comic that Marvel made about Ted Turner and AOL. And the future of Earth is supposed to be, like, analogous to Krypton. And so they send the son of Ted Turner back in time into the 2000s. And the reason it's called Mar-Vell is because it's also parodying Smallville. And, like, every comic cover was, like, a fucking half-nude, like, bikini model shoot of, like, Mary Jane.
I've seen a couple of those images of, like, the covers, but I had no idea what the actual premise of the stories were.
Yeah,
That's wild.
It's bad. Anyway, Moon Knight.
Moon Knight.
Moon
Knight. Just the way he says it is so cool. He really accentuates my Moon Knight. He goes all out on the word moon, and it's great.
To do the voice, you got to both push it powerfully, but also have like a raspy whisper surrounding it. It's like Moon Knight.
Oh, gosh, it was awesome. I liked seeing that that they actually showed us the moment he became Moon Knight.
Yeah. Oh, man, it was... It legitimately kind of a funny thing. Like, it made me laugh. Like, seeing this extremely dramatic scene. Everyone's dead. Fucking Mark has dragged himself into this temple. He pulls out a gun and puts it under his chin. And you just hear Khonshu go, "What a waste." And he's just like...
By the way, is one of the darker things I've seen in Marvel is someone holding up a handgun to their head. To their own head.
Yeah.
That's gruesome.
It's a dark series, man. It's upsetting.
I will give it this, because people keep saying, ah, they're still pulling their punches. I mean, yeah, a little. Like, compared to Daredevil, I guess. But
they didn't make it fucking TVM.
Like, yeah, but you can't deny that this is considerably darker stuff than anything we've seen in the MCU. They did child abuse in this.
And they also, like, and to say that, like, it's darker than the rest of the MCU is also, like the rest of the MCU had a fucking child get her home mortar bombed and had to sit in rubble for 3 days with no food and no sense of safety with a bomb in front of her face.
Yeah, I guess that's... I don't know what it is about the difference between war and child abuse that makes child abuse a much more raw emotional topic, but somehow it does. Like, somehow,
it's because
the horror of war, you're like, okay, war's bad.
In war, you expect people to be looking to do you harm, but in your own home, you expect your family to protect you. And
I guess that's a good way to put it.
While one harming you is expected, the other is a betrayal.
Yeah, because I was brought to tears with the child abuse stuff, and it was just very dark.
Claiming that Mark intentionally murdered his brother out of jealousy is one of the worst things you can say to a child. Honestly, that mom should have not been living there anymore. If I was the dad and I knew she was saying this shit to our son, I'd be like, all right, you gotta fucking go somewhere. You can't.
Yeah,
this would be a
very big divorce case.
There's already enough grief in this household without you making more.
Yeah, I spent like a third of this episode crying because of the mom character. This was just brutally emotional to me. Good God, this episode is so... Also, Oscar Isaac's best performance, I think, in this episode to me was crying on the street after just not having it in him to go into the Shiva.
Yeah, that was rough. And I also appreciate that was such a complex thing for him, because it's like he felt mourning enough to go there, but he still couldn't give her the satisfaction. So it's like he was struggling with the woman she was at the end, the abuser who was breaking him mentally, versus the woman she was before, who was a caring and compassionate mother. And it's like he couldn't reconcile which one to think of more. So he did a half measure of going to the Shiva, but couldn't commit to it. And struggling to reconcile something like that just made him feel even more in grieving, and like the emotional weight of it all, of everything he had been through, because I guess he had already been Moon Knight by this point. They said that Steven has only been a divergent personality for like 2 months. But Layla knew about his suit and everything, and they were already married, but they didn't get married or even meet until after
the dad died. And so we know that last Layla heard, the mom was alive.
Yeah, so okay, then yeah, that definitely cements it. So
because there's the part where Steven says, this is my mom's apartment technically, and she says, wait, are you two talking again? So Layla doesn't know that the mom has passed.
Gotcha. Right. So yeah, it seems as though he's been Moon Knight for several years, but Mark has only been having to deal with Steven's day-to-day life for the past couple months.
And that makes a lot of sense with everything.
Yeah.
We've been seeing. This was an intense episode.
It really was. Side note, Tawarit, is that how you say her name?
I think so. Tawarit, close enough.
Hippo Lady. She is extremely endearing.
Oh, I love her. She's great.
Her fucking pulling their hearts out and be like, oh, look at that. It worked. And here was little old me worrying I'd blow your chest wide open. It's just like, oh, ma'am.
She's adorable. I also love her, like, excited and, like, having to kind of gear herself up to start the thing. She goes, oh, you know, it's been a while since we've had someone come through here. Hold on, I've got cards.
She's looking at what she's got to read and then, like, breathing and, like,
getting into... Yeah, she does the breathe in. Welcome, traveler. Oh, sorry, travelers. They made her so cute.
It was also funny, her being like, are you two twins? And one of them's like, kind of, and the other one's like, no.
Oh, gosh.
Such a good episode. I can't wait for the finale of this. Oh my God. Like, even with them being like 40-minute episodes, how do you wrap this shit up? Like, we gotta find some way for Mark to get out of the Field of Reeds, go through the Gate of Osiris, probably reconcile with Steven and bring him back somehow, return to the Land of the Living. It seems like Amit is already released. Probably have a big fight with Amit. Deal with Harrow. Get closure with Layla. Like, we gotta have, like, a season two, right? Or, like, a movie. Like...
Yeah, and we'll see. And they're kind of. I'm a little worried. I'm sure it'll be fine. I'm optimistic, you could say, but I'm still. I'm still. There's still a mild concern here because, you know, these Disney Plus shows have kind of developed a pattern of having an awful lot of shit to wrap up in the final episode, and they typically, I enjoy all of them, so they typically pull it off. But usually the final episode winds up being, like, my least favorite episode. Like, usually it's the second to last is the best one, and the last one is pretty good. That's kind of been the pattern for a lot. I think that's true of WandaVision for me. I'm like, that second to last episode was insanely cool, and then the last one was okay. And then same with Falcon and Winter Soldier. Same with Loki, I think. Maybe even the same with Hawkeye. I can't really remember the difference between the Hawkeye's last episode was awesome. I'm not gonna say that about Hawkeye.
Yeah, the Hawkeye finale was great. I didn't have nearly as much of a problem with the WandaVision finale as a lot of people seem to. I will die on the hill that the finale of Falcon and the Winter Soldier was fantastic.
I think they're both fantastic. I just think that in both of those cases, the second to last episode was better.
I will not agree, because the second to last episode of Falcon and the Winter Soldier was a single fight with John Walker in the first 5 minutes, and then the entire rest of the episode was character moments and a training montage. And while I love those character moments and I enjoy that training montage, to look at the last episode of Falcon and the Winter Soldier, of Sam being Captain America, of the resolution of John Walker realizing that he does still have to help people above everything else, of a lot of Bucky's first time getting to be a public hero and people thanking him.
Yeah, that's a good one.
Catapults that shit for me. Like, seeing the emotion on his face as people are thanking him and getting out. It's so good. The finale is genuinely fantastic, and I will fight people.
I think my only problem with the finale of Falcon and Winter Soldier is exactly the concern that I'm describing, where you kind of had a few too many things to do and for some reason didn't give yourself enough time, so there's like a couple moments in there that feel really rushed, like in particular Bucky and the old man. That it's like I feel like I wanted to see that scene.
I don't think it was necessary, because seeing the scene would just, like, you understand what happens during it. To see it would be, like, slow and awkward, and I feel like you're not losing anything by letting it be implied. I can understand wanting to see, like, the emotions of the actors, like, as they play it out, But I think it's one of those things where it plays much better in your head than it would actually on screen.
Yeah, that's fair enough. There's just some pacing in general, I guess. I'm hoping that they have enough time in this final episode to wrap up what they've got. Because it feels like they have a little bit less to wrap up than usual, which is kind of nice. Feels like they did all of the character wrap up this episode, pretty much. They did all of the emotional resolution of kind of Mark's arc at the very least, and really Steven's arc as well, if he's coming back. You've kind of done all of the emotional work, thankfully, and now your final episode can just be free Khonshu, kick Harrow's ass, and save the day.
Yeah.
And I like that.
I'm making a prediction. I'm still... you can call this a new fucking Mephisto thing if you want, but I'm still firmly of the idea that they've been setting up Jake. So I think we're going to do the entire finale. We're going to have... I've got two alternate predictions. I'm going to say the one that I believe more strongly will happen first, and then the one that is possible, but less likely in my eyes. The first is I think we're going to have the entire finale. We're going to wrap things up. We're going to have like a quiet moment. And maybe we'll have a shot of that mental asylum again. And the fucking sarcophagus pops open and Jake comes out. And he's just like, hey, bada bing, what the fuck? Like, and so like, it'll be like, oh, Jake will appear in season two or whatever. Or the alternative to this is Mark being like, oh, Steven's fucking stoned. I can't do this alone. Like, I have a chance to save Steven if I can, you know, beat Amit and all this stuff for XYZ reason. But I can't do this alone. I'm too unbalanced. I'm too fucked up. I need help. And he remembers that sarcophagus. So he goes, maybe Tower is there with the boat to pick him up. Which makes the Field of Reeds thing feel very pointless to me, but whatever. Yeah. And he goes back in, he opens up the other sarcophagus, and he teams up with Jake for the last episode.
That'd be cool.
And then they rescue Steven. But I kind of like just the having Jake pop out at the very end of season one and not get to do anything until later.
Yeah.
Because a lot of this,
dude, season... I would pay good money if the last line of this song of this show is, "Bada bing, what's going on?"
Hey, bada bing, where the hell am I?
Hey, bada bing. I'd give anything for that to be the last line of this show.
I've been given the racism card by Jay for Italians, so it's okay.
Oh, is Jay Italian?
Yeah, his last name is fucking Vicarelli.
Oh, that's so funny. My girlfriend also Italian.
Because when he was like, here's my Twitter, because he finally made a Twitter and he was plugging it. I'm like, can you please spell your last fucking name? and he's like, oh, you know us Italians.
Well, you know.
And he was like, you can't be racist against Italians. We make the best pasta.
Oh yeah,
it's true, though. I hope nobody gets mad at me.
Dude, we've probably been canceled for something by now anyway. Good God, it's okay. I'm dating an Italian.
Guys, my best friend is black. It's fine.
Have you seen? And would you want these rumors that there might? Not rumors, mostly just speculations, that it would be kind of cool if the post-credit scene of Moon Knight is Gore the God Butcher showing up and killing either Khonshu or some other Egyptian god.
God Butcher. I know that character, but where... What?
So, Gore...
Is Thor character?
Yes, Gore the God Butcher is going to be the villain of Thor 4, which... premieres on July 8th. It's coming up pretty fast.
Okay.
And from the trailer of Thor, we see Zeus,
So I get the sense that we're probably going to show Gore like fucking lay waste to Olympus in Thor 4. And he's clearly after Thor at some point because
do you think Hercules will pop up in Thor?
I think so. We're going to Olympus.
Because Hercules is a Marvel character.
Yeah, we're going to Olympus. He made out with
Wolverine that one time.
Yeah. Yeah, they've definitely got Zeus in this movie, for sure. He's in the trailer. Oh,
I didn't actually know that. I didn't see him. All right.
Yeah, Zeus is in the trailer for Thor, Love and Thunder. And so I'm like, okay, so I'm betting we go to Olympus just to see how scary Gore is.
Hey, wait a minute.
That what?
Did they fucking do God of War?
That's kind of Gore's story, yeah. He pretty much is.
I mean, yeah, sure. I remember
he
that.
He pretty much is Kratos.
But no, I'm talking about fucking the Greek god meeting fucking Thor and, like, because Kratos is the son of Zeus. And
oh, that's funny. Yeah, that's... His story is very similar to Kratos' story. Do you know Gore's, like, backstory?
I know a little bit here and there. I am not super well-versed on his character.
Neither am I, but as I've heard it told, he's a character who, like, his family was dying or something horrible was happening, and he prayed desperately for anyone to listen, for anyone to help. No one helped. His family has died. And so he has decided gods must not be real. And then he at some point encounters one. And upon learning that gods exist, he becomes furious that they didn't help. And so he makes it his mission to go kill every god, anything even resembling a god, including celestials, I think. I don't know. But he's like, yeah, anything that could possibly be considered a god, I'm going to go kill it.
I mean, yeah, to be fair, celestials are more gods than, like, the Greek gods and Norse gods are, so...
Yeah, Ereshkigal is much closer to being a god than Thor is, in the sense of the word god.
Yeah, exactly.
But yeah, so I think that if we've got a character who is named the God Butcher in a movie, and you are abruptly introducing Zeus and Olympus into the Thor franchise, you're probably just doing it to show us how scary Gore is. So we can have a bunch of gods we've never met before for Gore to go kill.
You know what? Two things I gotta say. First, I just realized how fucking awful it is that they didn't ever in fucking Eternals mention that Thanos was an Eternal.
Yeah, kind of.
Well, because... only at the end. Because, like, they mentioned Thanos happening... And then only at the very end did we get fucking Harry Styles or whoever he is being his brother. Eris. And it's like, that's not the same as, like, in the middle of the Eternals movie acknowledging that one of your own fucking did this bullshit to this planet. Like, they referenced Thanos as though he was just some other fucking dickhead that they had no affiliation with. But in the comics... Thanos is an Eternal. He's just a fucked up, great, grimace-looking Eternal.
Yeah, I don't know how they're gonna play that up. I have no idea.
Yeah, but anyway,
Don't know how some of the Eternals are gonna line up with Greek mythology if they're revealing now that there is actual Greek mythology characters.
Like the idea that Athena is based on Athena, which means that if that's the case, then Athena can't be a fucking... God, I don't like Eternals. I'm sorry. I think it was a completely unnecessary addition to the MCU, and I don't think it was executed very well. Okay, it's not an Eternals episode. It's fine. Anyway, all this is to say, I kind of don't want Gore to pop up at the end of Moon Knight. I don't think that would be a good deal.
Yeah, I don't think it would. I think it would be too confusing.
Plus, like, killing Khonshu would... sort of fuck up the future for Moon Knight. Like, I want more Moon Knight. I don't want less.
You'd have to kill some other Egyptian god, and we haven't... I guess we've met Tower... That would be fucking heartbreaking. Don't do that, please.
Kill the dickhead in the suit.
Yeah. Kill Osiris.
Was that Osiris?
I think it was? this?
Like, none of them were really saying each other's names. We only got the one lady's name, and I can't remember who she was.
Hathor. Yeah, on the council, they said who was there, but they didn't, I don't think they mentioned each other by name. But there were only five of them, and the Osiris's name was listed first, and he seemed to be the leader, so I'm guessing that guy was Osiris.
Okay.
But, I don't know.
Whatever, Osiris is just the son of Ra. He's not a big deal. Kill him. Who cares?
Yeah, just kill him. Kill Osiris. Yeah.
All right.
I don't think that Gore's going to show up. I just think it's an interesting thought since we're dealing with gods here, and in 2 months we're going to deal with a bunch more gods.
That's true.
Maybe we'll revisit some of these Egyptian gods in that movie now that they've been established. Maybe that's when you kill Osiris.
That's true.
In the Thor movie to show us that, yeah, this dude's a... Gore is scary. You should be afraid of Gore.
God, I hate it when you have omniscient beings and they're just like, well, we have no reason to believe that this man has committed the acts that you... This is not a human courtroom. You can literally just look at Egypt and be like, oh yeah, look, a bunch of his boys are digging up the sand there. Well, there you go. Yeah,
that was like, very annoying. That was...
You do not need a defendant to provide the burden of proof when you are omniscient, motherfucker. One of you can fucking turn the sky 2,000 years back, yeah, and you can't take a look at the fucking tomb.
I love that. I love the audacity in that courtroom to go, yeah, he said he didn't do it. What more do you fucking want from me?
Use your god power, you fuck.
He said he didn't do it. He seems trustworthy. Look at that hair. He seems nice.
Absolutely infuriating.
I hated that. I also hated Harrow's ableism in that scene.
Yeah. Fucking sickening. All right.
Anywho. Are we done? You got anything else on Moon Knight right now? I don't.
I don't think so. I'm very excited for the finale. I can't wait.
All right. Like we said at the top of the show, go check out the latest episode of Cape Corner. It was a real laugh. You can follow Blue's show Cape Corner at Cape Corner on Twitter. You can also follow Blue's Unhinged Views on at Beyond Blue 13. I say that like I don't post exactly the same kind of stuff.
Look. You're correct, but you shouldn't have said it like that.
It's how I always say it. It's like, if you want to follow the show, you follow at Fandom Optimists. If you want to see my unhinged ranting, you go to at Jordan Blue Man. But don't do that. You will be disappointed.
If you want to see me scream at people about why Goku isn't a fucking mastermind...
If you want to see me be the Fandom Optimist, go to at Fandom Optimists. If you want to see me yelling at people about politics, you go to at Jordan Blue Man. It's not as fun an experience, I promise. Anywho, I think that's all there is to plug at the moment. Doctor Strange in the Multiverse of Madness premieres next week, but we will not be covering it next week. This show will still cover the finale of Moon Knight. And then the week after, we will most likely be doing Doctor Strange in the Multiverse of Madness. We may or may not have a surprise for you that week. Who knows? Yeah. Yeah. That's all I got. Until next time, y'all, never apologize for loving your fandom and try to stay optimistic. I'll see you next week.
Bye.